champion Sparkplug 400 from Brooklyn, Michigan is next. Our drivers are out for more Grand National Glory.
And with the auto racing head, that's it for SportsCenter Plus. I'm Karen Smith.
SportsCenter Plus has been brought to you by Hitachi, a world leader in technology. That's quality. That's Hitachi.
National racing has always been known for its great competition, and this year the parity is demonstrated even further by the fact that in 19 races, 12 different drivers have visited the winner's circle. Cale Yarborough at Daytona, Talladega, and Pocono. Ricky Rudd at Richmond. Bobby Allison at Rockingham and Charlotte. Benny Parsons at Atlanta. Darrell Waltrip at Bristol, Darlington, and Nashville. Tim Richmond at North Brooksboro. Jeff Bodine at Martinsville and Nashville. Richard Petty at Dover and Daytona. Harry Labonte at Riverside. Bill Elliott at Michigan. Harry Gant at Pocono and Dale Earnhardt at Talladega. Will there be a 13th, or will we see a repeat winner? Stay with us for live coverage of the Champion Spark Plug 400. ESPN, your number one auto racing network, presents from Michigan International Speedway, Auto Racing 84. Speedway. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Bob Jenkins along with Larry Neuber. This is the most competitive NASCAR season ever. The points battle is close. We've had 12 different winners in 19 races. As we look up front for today's race, we see a couple of so-called youngsters, Bill Elliott and Phil Parsons.
You might say it's kind of a surprise front row. Certainly not for Bill Elliott. This is the fifth time in his career that this young racer from Georgia has been up front on the pole position. But for Phil Parsons, his first time ever on the front row. Both of those people want to do very well, of course, here today.
Dick Bergeron, the editor of Stock Car Racing Magazine, will be in the pit area for today's activity. Here's Dick.
Bob, it's going to be a pretty frantic race this afternoon. All of these teams think all the Grand National races are important, but this one is especially important. Right now is when the major corporations are determining their 1985 advertising budgets, including sponsorship advertising budgets. So they need to look really well here this afternoon. There are a lot of teams looking for a limited amount of money, including Bud Moore's team, Robert Harrington's team, the Ramach team, Hoss Ellington's team, the Race Hill Farms team, Trevor Boy's team. They need to do well here this afternoon in order to attract that money. And in addition, there are a lot of driver changes afoot here. So everybody wants to do well. About 50% of the teams are in flux. Bob?
Thank you, Dick. Today's Champion Spark Plug 400 is brought to you by Pontiac. Test drive a new Pontiac at your Pontiac dealer, because at Pontiac, we build excitement. By Levi Garrett Chewing Tobacco. Time after time, the quality comes through. And by world-famous Bardol. Get Bardol, the engine saver. We'll be back with the starting lineup for today's Champion Spark Plug 400 in just a moment.
Pontiac unleashes the new 2000 Sunbird Turbo. One of the world's most technically advanced turbos. It pumps in huge quantities of air and pumps out 150 horsepower when you need it, when you want it. Agile, responsive. Oh, yeah. 2000 Sunbird Turbo. Only from Pontiac.
We build excitement.
We're talking stock cars. Number 98, that Levi Garrett car. Say that flavor. Say it proud.
Levi Garrett.
Say it loud.
Levi Garrett.
Say that flavor coming through.
The quality comes through. That quality by Garrett is the brand I'm proud to use. Levi Garrett.
The 40 cars in today's champion Spark Plug 400 begin to move away onto the high banks of Michigan International Speedway. It's a beautiful day. The temperature is 70 degrees. Winds from the north at about 10 miles an hour. There is a 20% chance of rain, 81% humidity. But right now we have partly sunny skies and beautiful conditions. The cars come off of turn number two and head down the backstretch. And we check now for you the starting lineup for today's Champion Spark Plug 400 from Michigan International. On the pole from Dawsonville, Georgia, in the Coors-Melling Ford, Bill Elliott in car number 9. Outside row 1, car number 66, Bill Parsons from Denver, North Carolina, in the Eckers Gold Bandit Chevy. Second row, car number 33, Harry Gant from Taylorsville, North Carolina, in the Gold Bandit Chevrolet. Outside of row number 2, Damon Pearson from Spartanburg, South Carolina, in the Chattanooga Choo Chevy number 16. In the third row, car number 55, Benny Parsons from Ellerby, North Carolina, in the Copenhagen Chevrolet. Outside of row number 3, Terry Labonte, car number 44. He's from Trinity, North Carolina, drives the Piedmont Airlines Chevy. Row number 4, car 11, Darrell Waltrip from Franklin, Tennessee, in the Budweiser Chevy. And alongside in row number 4 will be Rusty Wallace from Greensboro, North Carolina, in the number 88 Gatorade Pontiac. Fifth row, car number 28, Cale Yarborough from Timminsville, South Carolina, in the Hardy Chevrolet. Outside of row number 5, from Chesapeake, Virginia, Ricky Rudd, car number 15, the Wrangler Gene Ford. In the sixth row, Tim Richmond from Northville, North Carolina, in the number 27 Old Milwaukee Pontiac. Outside of row number 6, the driver of car number 5, Jeff Bodine from Pleasant Garden, North Carolina, in the Northwestern Security Life Chevrolet. The rest of the lineup, 7th row, Joe Rutman and Dale Earnhardt. 8th row, Dave Marcus and Jody Ridley. In row number 9, Ron Bouchard and Buddy Baker. 10th row, Rodney Combs and Lake Speed. In the 11th row, Neil Bonnet and Richard Petty. 12th row, Greg Saxon, Bobby Hillen Jr. 13th row, Clark Dwyer and Kyle Petty. 14th row, Sterling Marlin and Buddy Arrington. In row number 15, Ronnie Thomas and Trevor Boys. 16th row, Bobby Allison and Morgan Shepherd. Row number 17 consists of Tommy Ellison, Dean Combs. 18th row, Jimmy Means and Mike Alexander. Row number 19, Doug Heverin and Dick Brooks. And in the 20th row, Ken Schrader and Jeff Hooker.
Well, if ever there were parity being shown in this series, it would be the fact that 300 victories are starting behind 20th position today. There's a man, however, has never won a Grand National Stock Car race, Rodney Combs. He qualified very well here today in 19th position. He'll be starting back there with Richard Petty, Bonnet, and Lake Speed. He'll be in that group. Now, Rodney is a graduate of the late model racing in the Cincinnati, Ohio area. He's been spending most of the last couple of years, however, running on the dirt tracks, the NDRAM All-Star Circuit. He's in the former Jim Stacy, now Booby Harrington team here at Michigan this week.
The track is 2 miles in length. We'll go 200 laps to make up the Champion Spark Plug 400. Bill Elliott leads them down toward the green flag. Harold Kinder waves the green, and we are underway. This racetrack leads to drafting and always excitement. As you can see, they're going 4 abreast through turn number 1. At the front of the pack, they're being led off of turn number 2 down the backstretch by pole sitter Bill Elliott from Dawsonville, Georgia. Kind of a hometown favorite, his car owner hails from Jackson, Michigan, which is the largest city close to Michigan International Speedway. And Bill has a win on this racetrack. You can see he's opened up a considerable advantage here in the opening lap as the drivers battle for second position. Here they come off of turn 4 for the completion of lap 1. Elliott runs first, then it's Harry Gant, followed by Bill Parsons, David Pearson, and Terry Labonte.
Oh, Bob, I believe that the word awesome is overused in contemporary modern society, but I gotta tell you, it is probably the only word appropriate to describe the way Elliott has dominated this field this week. He was about a half a second faster than everybody and almost 1.5 miles per hour quicker than the remainder of the field.
Cale Yarborough making a move toward the front. He's running alongside Dale Earnhardt right now with Tim Richmond trailing. Cale is up high on the racetrack and allows both Earnhardt and Tim Richmond to slip by. Pursuing that group is Jeff Bodine and Ricky Rudd. run. Once again, off of turn number four, this completes lap number two. Bill Elliott still has the lead. And Harry Gant still runs in second position. The black flag is being given to number 48, Trevor Boys, who had a terrible accident at Daytona, or rather at Talladega, earlier this year.
There you see that battle for, about 5th through 12th. There's a lot of this 2, 3, 4, and even sometimes 5 abreast racing here at the Michigan International Speedway, and this is just typical of what you'd expect. Also, the track seems to be very easy on the cars. About 30 cars always seem to finish here at Michigan International Speedway. It can have a dramatic effect on the season-long point standing. There you see a large contingent of people, and really doesn't do any good at this moment, at least, to say what position they're fighting for. They're up near the front. That's good enough. And the guy up in the upper right-hand corner of your screen right now is somebody that you can expect to be up near the front all day long. A lot of people watch what happens in that orange and white 28 pit. Kind of judge how well they're doing in every Grand National event.
The traditional 3, 4, and sometimes even 5 abreast racing through the tri-oval here in Michigan. This is not a complete oval, but rather a tri-oval. The turns are banked at 18 degrees, and off of turn number 4, instead of a straightaway, there is another turn here in front of the grandstand.
Well, as we watch this large flock of cars fluttering around the Michigan International Speedway, sorry to report for the Canadian fans that Trevor Boys has already been in the pits twice. And there's Dale Earnhardt really getting squirrely coming out of turn number 4. You can see it vividly there on your screen. He gathered it back up just in time as Yarbrough was right between Earnhardt and the outside wall. Another driver whom we showed you at the top of the show has already been in the pits once also, and that was Rodney Combs. So the attrition, which we don't expect to be great again, here, look at that racing. Isn't that terrific?
They're in turn number 2, and they're 3 abreast. Among the drivers in this group, the number 88 of Rusty Wallace. Number 27 is driven by Tim Richmond. Cale Yarbrough on the outside of Tim Richmond. Bill Parsons also in this group as they head toward turn number 3. This is the battle for second position now. Bill Elliott has the lead out in front of this group. They come off of turn number 4. The group involves Harry Gant, Terry Labonte, David Pearson, and the number 11 of Darrell Waltrip.
And as they race 2, 3, and 4 breaths, look at Elliott. Gives him an advantage. Right now, there are 3 or 4 cars times 3,700 pounds trying to break through air. And that's an advantage for the race leader, Bill Elliott, who continues to run right where he has since just before they crossed the start-finish line at the beginning of this race, way out front in the number one position. Look at the lead that Elliott has. That's almost unheard of, particularly in the early laps here at Michigan International.
Racing is important here in Michigan, but not as important as it is on some of the other racetracks like Talladega and Daytona. We'll see a lot of it this afternoon, but it perhaps will not play as important a factor as it will on some of the other racetracks. Harry Gant turns off of corner number 4, brings it onto the tri-oval. Harry has moved himself into second spot. He's being trailed by Darrell Waltrip, Terry Labonte, and David Pearson. After that, it's Ricky Rudd, Rusty Wallace, and then that group of cars that contains Bill Parsons and Cale Yarbrough, among others.
Harry Gant, he won the last ESPN televised race at Pocono. He has led something like the last four races on the trail and 5 of the last 6. Waltrip, of course, would like to do well. And there's that group of cars that's about, we say, approximately 6th through 20th, and somewhere in there. There he is in the middle of the screen. Look at Richard Petty on the outside, 4 wide, going down the backstretch into turn number 3. Petty has come from way back behind 20th position, and he has been roaring to the front like he was shot out of a cannon.
Richard Petty, who won his 200th career victory earlier this year at Daytona, is moving up through traffic now. In front of him is Ron Bouchard, but Petty has made a nice move here in the early going at Michigan. We've completed 7 laps now. Bill Elliott continues to hold the lead, but this gaggle of cars racing for 6th through about 15th position. Petty still on the high side of the racetrack. That apparently is his line for the early going here at Michigan. He's alongside Ron Bouchard now, passing him on the outside and continuing to click off positions and move toward the front.
Petty started 22nd to be exact. Look who he's caught up with. Cale Yarbrough. He's right now on the high side of the points leader, Dale Earnhardt. But Richard is really hooked up. Richard Petty is moving on the high side. We are accustomed to seeing him there, but boy, is he coming up through this field. Now, this team has recently left the DieGuard stable in regards to the engine construction. They were buying engines from Robert Yates and the DieGuard people until about 3-4 weeks ago, and they decided to terminate that arrangement. A little bit of ruffled feathers among both of the parties involved, but now the Petty Enterprises people are putting together their own engines. I'll tell you, whatever they did to the one they've inserted in this car today, it's working much better than it did during qualifying. Lots of trading of positions. Once again, I think we're going to go four abreast.
Four abreast down the backstretch. The car on the very inside of the racetrack is Dale Earnhardt. Tremendous racing here in Michigan, and Cale Yarborough is the lead car in this pack and is running in sixth position. They move off of turn number four onto the trioval once again, and here's a car making a move into the pit area. That is the number 45 of Jeff Hooker from Valley City, Ohio. Jeff started this race in last position in 40th spot. He is bringing his car in for an early pit stop. We expect at least three pit stops in this going here this afternoon, and of course more depending upon the yellows. Richard Petty continues to move up. Right now, running behind Ricky Rudd in car number 15. Right now, Richard Petty is in eighth spot, and there is the leader, Bill Elliott, from Dawsonville, Georgia. Back with more live coverage from Michigan International Speedway in just a moment.
Here's a helpful hint from Bardol, the engine saver. The next time you change your oil, add a can of Bardol Oil Booster for extra engine protection. Here's why. When you start a cold engine, most of the oil is sitting in the crankcase. That leaves your cylinders without full protection and can cause engine wear. But Bardol Oil Booster is specially formulated. It clings to metal surfaces to help oil protect your engine. So for extra protection for your car, turn to the complete line of quality products from Bardol, the engine saver.
The worst stock market crash in history rocked the nation yesterday.
On October 24th, 1929, the news that shocked the world didn't surprise everyone. 2 months earlier, Business Week readers were warned about stock prices that seemed unsteady. Business Week was then only a few weeks old.
Today, the look of the magazine has changed, but not its significance. Business Week interprets, even anticipates, and that's important, because in business, nobody likes to be taken by surprise.
Business Week magazine revealed this week.
Subscribe to Business Week right now, and you'll get 32 issues at the low basic rate of only $24.95. A savings of more than 60% off the cover price. And along with your paid subscription, Business Week will send you one more valuable business tool, the Business Week Solar Calculator, free. Business Week, it's one business opportunity you don't want to miss. Order now.
To order, call toll-free 1-800-544-1000. That's 1-800-544-1000.
Monday, Prudential's Inside Baseball reviews the USA's performance in Olympic exhibition. The home team put on quite a show. Catch it. Next, it appears Aaron Pryor has more desire in a title fight with Alexis Arguello. See them slug it out in their Super Bowl of the 80s. Then, Big John Jackson looks to level gentleman Bill Morrison in a PKA Super Heavyweight Contenders bout. You'll get a kick out of it. Join us for boxing, baseball, and more Monday.
As we look at Bill Elliott in the lead, there's quite a story going on with Bobby Allison running way back in 23rd. He did not qualify well, so yesterday, all day long, they flogged the car trying to make the chassis run better and better. By the end of the day, they were among the top five. They got together in the motel room last night, though, and decided top five is not enough. They wanted to be right on top. So this morning, they went in the garage and they changed the whole chassis. Springs, shock absorbers, everything. And this is an untried, untested combination. Worse, if this thing doesn't work, they can't change it back to where they were before. The strategy here is go for a win. These guys want to be champion again in 1984, as they were in 1983. They say the only way they can do that is to win. And they'd like to do just that here at Michigan.
Well, Nick, Bobby Allison is moving up very slowly. He has picked up another position. He's now up into 22nd spot, but not making the charge to the front that we had anticipated. And look at this. Phil Parsons in number 66 started second, has fallen way back to 24th position at this point.
Phil has qualified in the top 10 before. He had certainly hoped to be able to hold a little closer to the lead draft. Not only, Bob, has he dropped back over 20 positions, but he is losing contact with the first 20 cars in this race. Elliott still has the lead. Waltrip, incidentally, has cut into it just a little bit as we continue to watch Phil Parsons. There are the first three cars. You can see that Waltrip has cut into the lead a little bit. Terry Labonte runs in third. They're not really close at all. Those first three cars are all strung out. And Harry Gant is just about equal distance between, or behind rather those first three cars. Then in fifth is David Pearson, and finally that batch of cars that was battling for 6th through 20th.
Positions being traded here among Ricky Rudd, Dale Earnhardt, and Ron Bouchard. From top to bottom on your screen is Dave Joyce in battle for position, following right behind Richard Petty.
Now there you can see the two Wrangler cars of Dale Earnhardt and Ricky Rudd. They switched sides from a year ago, and now David Pearson comes into the pit area. David Pearson, who was running in fifth position. Pearson had qualified fourth fastest here today. It looked like he was in a position, perhaps one of his finest in quite some time. It's been a while since David Pearson has won his last race coming at, his last win coming at Darlington back in 1980.
And he is the winningest driver here at Michigan International. He has taken the checkered flag 9 times, but it looks like that his chances of winning here are going to be down the drain as the crew continues to work on that car. We go back to this battle here for 9th, 10th, and 11th position. This is the battle for 10th. It involves the number 15 of Ricky Rudd and Ron Bouchard on the inside.
Well, Ron Bouchard there in the yellow and white blue number 47 was able to get one of the real key members of the Die Guard racing team over to his crew. And Bouchard hopes that will really help him out a lot.
Ron Bouchard, 35 years of age, driving the Race Hill Farms Buick. We had an opportunity to talk with Ron about his crew change earlier this weekend.
Ron, do you see him on the threshold of some upcoming finishes and wins?
Well, this is true, Dick. We've had a lot of bad luck here all year, really. But, you know, the cars performed well. And Wayne Bumgardner, our new crew chief, has really done a heck of a job the last two races. So maybe this race in Michigan could be the one.
We have had several crew chief changes since we visited with you last, and we'll tell you about those as the afternoon wears along. Meanwhile, we look toward the top, and it's Darrell Waltrip has moved in on Bill Elliott, and now Waltrip is looking to challenge for the lead as these cars streak down the backstretch. Darrell Waltrip moves to the inside of Bill Elliott and passes. We have now had two leaders in this race. Darrell Waltrip takes the lead on lap number 17.
And Waltrip right now has got to be feeling really good about what's happening. Not that Darrell hasn't won enough the past 3 years, but Waltrip has had a very difficult time, particularly on the super speedways in 1984. Matter of fact, both he and his teammate, Neil Bonnet. Waltrip has only been dominant, really, a couple of times this year, and both of those times were on a track of different configuration than this, once at Richmond and once at Darlington. But Waltrip looks as racy as we have seen him all year on a super speedway.
There are your first two. Running in third position now is Terry Labonte, and fourth is Harry Gant. We'll be back with more live coverage of this Champion Spark Plug 400, the 20th race on the Grand National Circuit for 1984.
The 6000 STE from Pontiac is America's performance sedan. An engineering masterpiece that gives you an amazing command of the road. 6000 STE. Technically advanced. Totally satisfying. 6000 STE. Only from Pontiac.
We build excitement. Pontiac.
Hi, this is Jerry Lewis for the Muscular Dystrophy Association. And these are some of my kids visiting the world-famous Budweiser Clydesdale. This year, once again, Anheuser-Busch is pledging over $2 million to muscular dystrophy. So look for these displays wherever you buy Bud and Bud Light. It's your chance to join the fight against muscular dystrophy. And thank you from all of my kids.
David Pearson won his first stock car race on a dirt track in South Carolina. And has gone on to win over 100 NASCAR Grand National races. But even though there's always another race,
how's that?
There's more to David's life than just racing.
Hey, now that looks like a wreck.
Nah, looks like supper, Dad.
Looks like it's time for some Chattanooga Chew.
Get all you can out of life. Get on board with Chattanooga Chew.
Don't worry, they're wearing Dickies work clothes. Dickies are shape set, fortified with Fortrel. If Dickies can make the Three Stooges look good, imagine how great you'll look. Michigan, where a two-car battle has somehow become a three-car battle. Darrell Waltrip continues to lead, but now the battle is for second position. Terry Labonte and Bill Elliott run side-by-side down the backstretch into three. While we watch this, let's talk with the guy who started fourth in this race, but is out, David Pearson.
David, what happened to your car?
Well, the upper control arm mount on the frame where the upper control arm bolts onto it, it broke off. And, of course, that's something we can't understand. We never have seen one of them right before, you know. And so I guess it's just one of those things.
Now, the upper control arm mainly holds the steering together in the car. How tough was it to drive the car with that thing broken?
Well, I knew something was happening because I was more or less just right, you know, right where I wanted to be. Everything was working real fine. And all at once, it just acted like something had broke, you know, and it was getting worse and worse and what it was doing. The A-frame was kept moving on in further and further, and of course it messed the front end up.
Well, the winningest driver here at Michigan is going to have to watch the rest of this event from the sidelines.
There's the battle for the lead. Darrell Waltrip, Bill Elliott, and Terry Labonte. Labonte once again challenging Bill Elliott in turn number three. While we were away from break, we had a spin as Jeff Hooker tried to, it looked like, come into the pits, but lost control momentarily, but a great job of gathering that car in.
Bobby really did. I thought he had it a couple of times and just kept going out of control repeatedly on him. You can see him, he's back up to speed. I thought perhaps his tire had gone down, but this is a young man from northern Ohio, northeastern Ohio, over in the Cleveland, Akron, Canton area, who Herb Nabb helped get into the race today, and a couple of anxious moments there. Up front, some anxious moments for Waltrip and Elliott as they go side by side once again down that flat backstretch at the Michigan International Speedway.
Waltrip with the advantage. Elliott settling back into second spot. Perhaps he'll try the slingshot off of the backstretch into turn number three. He's not doing it this time, but Terry Labonte is as he challenges Bill Elliott for third spot. Running fourth is Harry Gant. In sixth position is Cale Yarborough. Sixth is Richard Petty, all the way from 22nd starting position. Seventh is Dale Earnhardt. Eighth is Ron Bouchard. Ninth is Ricky Rudd. And tenth is Benny Parson. 11th is Jody Ridley. In 12th spot is Jeff Bodine. 13th is the number two. And the 14th position belongs to number seven, Kyle Petty.
Now, this is an interesting trio up front. Bill Elliott normally doesn't charge, so you get an idea of how well Elliott feels today in terms of the mechanical performance of his race car. The body is always close to the front, but doesn't always lead a lot of laps, and we mentioned to you earlier that Waltrip just has not had that good of a year on the super speedways, but boy, he is really sailing here today, and he flexed a lot of muscle. He was not content to ride behind Elliott. You know, it's certain for sure that the race is not going to be won before the first pit stop or even in the first 300 laps. And so when Darrell Waltrip is running up front and running this fast compared to the rest of the field early on, I can guarantee you that he feels as though he's in a very good position for the rest of this race.
Boy, there is a great battle there for second spot as Bill Elliott and Terry Labonte have been going at it real heavily for about the last five laps as they came off of turn number four last lap. Terry Labonte moved up in front of Bill Elliott to take over second spot, but as you can see, Elliott is back in that position. These are the first three, Waltrip, Bill Elliott, and Terry Labonte. We've completed 25 laps out of 200 that will make up this Champion Spark Plug 400. Michigan International Speedway houses this beautiful two-mile tri-oval, and during the year, the Indy cars run here twice, and the Grand National cars run here twice. We will have a telecast from here in September of the Indy cars. They put on a great show here and run well over 200 miles an hour. Top qualifying speed this weekend for the Grand National cars, a record 165.217 miles an hour. So once again, the battle is for second position as Terry Labonte moves down to the inside of Bill Elliott and tries to once again move into second spot. Back with more from Michigan after these messages.
Racing from the inside. No one covers it like Auto Week. Auto Week makes you an insider at the world's great race circuits every week. In the pits, behind the scenes, even in the cockpit with racing driver columnists in Formula One, NASCAR, and CART. Inside coverage just days after the race. And Auto Week puts you inside the world's most exciting cars, right behind the wheel. Auto Week takes you inside the whole automotive scene. Personalities, great cars of the past, columnists with inside scuttlebutt. Let Auto Week make you an insider, too. Call for a year's subscription to Auto Week. 52 issues at the basic price of $23, just 44 cents an issue. Call 1-800-544-1000. And get this $8 Auto Week t-shirt absolutely free. Call right now, 1-800-544-1000. Let Auto Week make you an insider.
28 laps have been completed, and up front, Darrell Waltrip, followed by Bill Elliott, and right behind him, Terry Labonte.
Well, before we went to the last commercial break, you were talking about the speed that was qualified here for the top spots in qualifying this week. It was a very competitive field. Bill Elliott was about a half a second ahead of the second fastest qualifier, but the second through the 31st cars, repeat, second through 31, just 1 second on the clock separating. Highly competitive. It was a real difficult field, really, to qualify into. We started 40 cars. Over 50 entered the race, and a couple minutes will run down for you. Some of the people were here and attempted to qualify and simply were not able to get up enough speed.
Jeff Bodine from Pleasant Garden, North Carolina, car number 5, continues to move up. He started this race in 12th position, and he has won twice this year on the Grand National Circuit.
Well, Jeff has got some problems here this afternoon, however. He's got something of an oil leak under the hood. The crew is really not sure the cause of Jeff Bodine's oil leak, and they hope it's going to be a minor problem. But these things seldom get better. They generally only get worse. At least for right now, the plan is to keep Bodine on the track, keep his foot flat on the throttle, and they hope this doesn't get to be a serious problem as the day wears on.
Dick, you know, we're watching Jeff Bodine, but you had talked about Bobby Allison earlier, and you told us that Allison, essentially, he and the crew rebuilt that race car. Now, are they in deep trouble for the rest of this race? Because they're obviously not fast early on here.
Well, Dick Bergeron will have comment on that just a little bit later, as Jeff Bodine, who started 12th, is continuing to run in 12th position. So the oiling problem that Dick mentioned isn't all that serious at the present time.
Well, back to that qualifying story, as we watch Jeff Bodine struggling to stay up with the lead pack. He's doing right smartly, I might add. We're looking at 15th through 20th position. There's Lake Speed, Kyle Petty. Also in that group is Rob Bouchard. So these are all people who have been close to the front during the last month of the Grand National season. So a lot of people still in. And also remember, there were about 20 cars on the lead lap most of the race at Talladega the last time, and 14 ended up crossing the finish line. Here's a partial list of some of the people who did not qualify. Don Paul, the son of a former Super Modified driver from nearby Berrien Springs, Michigan, was one of those who entered and just did not gender up enough speed to qualify. Grand National regular entrant J.D. McDuffie. H.B. Bailey, the man in gold and diamonds in his red and white number 36. The Alameda Auto Parts, National Motors Pontiac, is a non-qualifier. Bobby Gerhardt made the 10.5-hour drive from the Lebanon, Pennsylvania area in the Frederick Chevrolet. Really had very high hopes, had great expectations of being able to qualify for this race, and really was quite heartbroken when he did not get in. Del McCoward crashed attempting to qualify. Jim Hall, a former professional football player who has survived a bout with cancer, entered his first Grand National race ever, missed by about 2 seconds of qualifying. John Ingalls from Florida, Maurice Randall from nearby Charlotte, Michigan, and Dave Simcoe. They brought a brand new engine this week to qualify or attempt to qualify at his home Grand National track. He lives less than an hour away. They got 8 laps on it, and it blew up. And Simcoe had to be happy with running the ASA race last night at Berlin, Michigan.
Watching the 12th and 13th positions here, Lake Speed in car number 1 is running in 12th, and Ricky Rudd in number 15 is running in 13th spot. There's a good look at Lake Speed, who you remember qualified in 2nd position for the Pocono race that we telecast earlier this year. This week, Lake qualified for 20th starting position and has moved up 8 spots.
Lake has never won a Grand National Stock Car race, but it certainly looks like it's in the offing for him sometime in his career, and a lot of people think that it may happen very soon. Now we jump back up front to the first 3 guys, just to give you some progress on that. Not much has changed. It's been Waltrip, Elliott, Labonte, not necessarily in that particular order every lap. Darrell has had the better of it for the last 10 or 15 laps. Remember that Elliott, with his brand new track record,
led the first 10 laps or so. Since that time, Waltrip has stayed there in the vanguard, but he's been unable to shake both Elliott and Labonte. They may be waiting for that first pit stop, and maybe they can make a change that would once again make them superior.
34 laps have been completed, and we have been green all the way. Now, Jeff Hooker did momentarily get out of control at the pit entrance, but gathered the car in. It did not bring on the caution light, and the green has been out all the way so far. Two leaders, Darrell Waltrip and Bill Elliott. At this point, only one car officially out of the race. That is David Pearson in car number 16.
Remember that fuel often is a big factor in Grand National stock car races. Bob mentioned earlier that we expect about three pit stops on a routine basis to get in the vicinity of 100 miles per gallon of gasoline, which means that anytime after about lap 45, we would expect to see the routine or the scheduled pit stops of all the top drivers. Anybody who goes past lap 50 is getting just tremendous fuel mileage, and depending upon how the caution flags fly after about lap 3,000 or after about mile 300, they could be in a really good position for victory.
The average speed of the race after 35 laps is 156.63 miles an hour. There are the top three. We'll be back for more action in just a moment.
Time. It takes time to create quality. The quality taste of Budweiser. Time to select the choicest ingredients. For exclusive Beechwood aging, to brew the distinctively clean, crisp taste of Budweiser. Quality taste. That's what people want in a cold glass of beer, and this is the one they want. Somebody still cares about quality.
New Nissan 200 SX Turbo is looking for a few good drivers.
Hey, you're talking to me.
The 200 SX Turbo, new fuel-injected engine and high-performance suspension. Major technology from Nissan.
Give me a turbo and I come alive.
Come alive, turbo, come and drive turbo. Major motion from Nissan.
At your Datsun dealer.
It's all here. In this lovely, peaceful corner of New York State. Memories. Memories of the great and legendary, of the bigger-than-life heroes of our youth. The Hall of Fame is the treasury of baseball's greatest memories and thrills. Baseball fever. Catch it at Cooperstown. It lasts forever.
Jenkins, Larry Neuber, and Dick Bergeron back at Michigan International Speedway, where 37 out of 200 laps in the Champion Sparkplug 400 have been completed. The top five. Darrell Waltrip running first. Bill Elliott is second. Terry Labonte third. Cale Yarborough fourth. And running in fifth spot is Dale Earnhardt. Darrell Waltrip has won three times this year on the Winston Cup Grand National Circuit. We ask him about competing here at Michigan on the high bank.
Well, this track is the track that I haven't won a lot here. I've had one victory here over my career so far. But it's a track that I usually finish very well at. I usually have a good, strong second, third, fourth place finish here. And right now, with the point situation being the way it is, a good, strong run here and a good, strong finish would be almost as good as a win.
Well, he's making a good, strong win right here as he is leading at this point, although Bill Elliott now moves to the inside in turn number one and looks for an opportunity to go back in the lead, but cannot find it. Waltrip looking very good here. Darrell started in 11th, rather in 7th position, qualifying at 161 miles an hour, almost 4 miles an hour slower than the pole sitter Bill Elliott, but the car is performing well on race day.
This is the 20th race of the year, and Darrell almost won the point at this very racetrack a year ago. Now, you might say, how can you do that on race 20? Well, Bobby Allison dropped out, more than 30 cars finished, and Waltrip picked up 109 points on Allison a year ago here at Michigan International. There is one of the real nice stories of this week at the Michigan International Raceway. Look at that, 10th place for Jody Ridley. Now, if you're a regular on the Grand National Trail in terms of a band, you know that Jody has struggled to get a ride. He had to put this entire program together himself for the 1984 season with the appropriately numbered 84. And Ridley has been struggling the last couple of years. He does have one career win. He's one of the few people who have graduated from late model racing over the past decade into Grand National Stock Car Racing. And this is a very nice day to this point for Jordy Ridley. He has had a top 10 finish. Matter of fact, a couple of them. He was 8th at Charlotte and 10th at Daytona earlier this year. But Jordy Ridley right now, well, he's racing up there with all them legends of stock car racing.
It's been green all the way, and we've completed 40 laps. Tommy Ellis is making a pit stop. Dick Bergeron, when can we expect the first regular series of pit stops to occur?
Well, Bob, anytime after about lap 45 or 50, you'll see them come in. But you also best believe that if there is a yellow flag anywhere between now and then, that everybody is going to come in for a load of fuel and a fresh set of tires. Now, if that first stop is on the caution, you'll see the majority of fast teams changing all four tires, taking on two cans of fuel. If it comes under the green, you're going to see him taking on the same two cans of fuel, but probably only two tires.
All right, Tommy Ellis has made his pit stop and is now back out there on the track. That was an interesting story at Talladega, as Tommy was among those who ran in that group of 15 cars or 11 cars that came down virtually side by side and nose to tail for the checkered flag.
Truly an incredible race, Bob, and really startling thing about it is you look at a Rusty Wallace or a Tommy Ellis or a Bobby Helen and think that they ran 500 miles at the world's fastest speedway. They were within 2 or 3 seconds of the winning car, and all they could get was 12, 13, 14 positions like that. Just truly an incredible race.
Bill Elliott has fallen from second spot back to third as Terry Labonte has moved into second spot. As Darrell Waltrip continues to lead, Waltrip has been in the lead since the 18th lap when he took over from Bill Elliott. 42 laps have been completed, so we are nearing the one-quarter mark of this 400-mile race.
Well, Darrell, despite not being quite as dominant, to say the least, as he has been in the 1982 and 83 seasons, is, or at least was, third in terms of the number of miles led in the 1984 season coming into this race. He had led 834 miles. The number one driver in terms of miles led was Cale Yarborough. So Waltrip's had a pretty decent year, to say the least. He has led a total of 11 races, but of course, a lot of those races, the top drivers, they use strategy to lead at least a couple of laps to pick up the 5-point bonus that is given to the driver or every driver who leads at least one lap in a race. So Waltrip is doing something that he did a lot of in the last 2 years, and he's been a little sporadic with leading miles this year, but boy, he sure does look strong here today.
There are the top three here on the tri-oval crossing the finish line, leading lap number 44. That's how close the first three are.
But they have been healthy, to say the least, when you compare them, Bob, to the rest of the field. They have been alone this whole race. Now, here's a pan back showing you where's fourth place. Where's it at? Where's it at? There it is. That group of cars right there, which includes Cale Yarborough, Richard Petty, and the number three car of Dale Earnhardt. But the first three have built up almost a half a lap lead under this first green flag segment, which has been a long one. We've gone 44 laps now. Anything happened the last time here without a yellow flag. No interruptions.
You know, Larry, this race is very similar to the International Race of Champions event that was held here at Michigan yesterday. Normally, you get all 12 cars running nose to tail. However, as Bill Elliott comes into the pit, we'll pick up on that story a little bit later. Right now, let's go to Dick, who's in the Bill Elliott area.
Well, this looks like a routine pit stop. It is under the green flag, so the crew is now working on the right side tires. One can of fuel is in, and they're preparing to toss the second can of fuel in. Another crew member wipes the windshield. Only 5 men over the wall allowed. There was a time when in NASCAR a lot more used to go over, but now they say 5 and no more, and they're watching it like a hawk.
All right, of course, the Fords don't get quite the gas mileage that the others do, and so Bill has been in earlier than the others.
Well, Dick, you know, even though only 5 people can be over the wall, actually there are up to 2 or 3 other crew members as some of the other pit stops begin who can participate in the pit stops. Is that not true? Well, apparently we have lost contact with Dick once again, but the fact of the matter is that there are 2 or 3 people who can actually get right up on the wall, as long as you're not over the wall, hand out drinks of water. See the one man there working on Phil Parsons' car cleaning the windshield. Now, he doesn't count in that 5 that is over the wall. He's not among those numbered 5 that keep him well within the rules. He's doing some work, though, but he's not among those first 5.
Phil Parsons started second, has dropped back drastically in the first quarter of this race. He's pulling back out onto the racetrack, having made his first official stop. Bill was running well back of 20th position when he came in. 47 laps have been completed now. There are the two leaders now as Bill Elliott has come in. Darrell Waltrip in the lead and Terry Labonte running in second spot. To pick up on that International Race of Champions story that I was talking about, yesterday it didn't turn out to be quite as exciting as I think everybody had anticipated. There's Junior Johnson, Darrell Waltrip's crew chief and car owner. A couple of the cars got out into the lead and pulled away from the others, and that's exactly what we're seeing here this afternoon.
Well, a lot of different factors, of course, can figure into the eventual outcome or the rhythm of a race, but it is a bit unusual to see the field get so strung out at the Michigan International Speedway. But the point of the matter is, as we look at the second running, Terry Labonte come in, it's been a very fast pace. We have not had any yellow flags. There are still about 20 cars on the lead lap, so even though the racing has not been door handle to door handle, there are still one heck of a lot of folks in it for a potential victory here today. Second place running, Terry Labonte. He's been second and third all day long. The Piedmont Airlines number 44. Dale Inman, the crew chief of this car, the crew chief who has won more Grand National stock car races than any other man in history. There is a driver who has won more Grand National stock car races in history. Most of those wins coming at the control and at the command of Dale Inman, his cousin. And there is Buddy Baker, yet another one of the legendary names coming from the deep south to go stock car races.
Others who are making pit stops include Dale Earnhardt, Kyle Petty, Joe Ruttman in number 98. Also, Greg Sachs is in, and one car did pull behind the pit wall on these stops. That was the number 97 of Dean Combs. There is Lake Speed in the Bullfrog Knit car as his crew has completed the work and is pushing him at least onto the apron, but it appears as if the car has stalled. Lake's trying to get the car restarted as the crew pushes him down the pit apron, but it doesn't look like they're having much success. Here is Benny Parsons, the winner at Atlanta earlier this year, coming in for a stop. The Copenhagen crew going to work on that machine. There's a good look at Benny Parsons, who will be joining us for a couple of races here in the broadcast booth as we present coverage of the late model sportsman and Darlington Dash race a little bit later in the season from Darlington, South Carolina. And Benny stands on the gas and broad slides the car as he pulls out of the pit.
And there's the leader, Darrell Waltrip. You see him pulling right by his teammate, Neil Bonded, who is also in the pits. We'll take you down into the Junior Johnson, Jeff Hammond pit. Darrell Waltrip comes to a stop. They pick the right side up. Waltrip getting a drink to pause that refreshes, looking very casual about the whole thing, adjusting the radio, perhaps having a brief conversation with Jeff Andor Jr., and Waltrip is ready to pull away. His teammate, Neil Bonded, actually beats him out of the pit road, but I think that Darrell was almost a full lap ahead, and there is Cale Yarborough, another one of the pre-race favorites. Right side rubber change on that as Yarborough picks up the pace as he comes out of the pit road and rumbles back under the 24-degree banking. The pit stops will really scramble the standings. You're going to see exactly how well every crew and driver in combination did getting their car into and out of the pits. And you know, Bob, there's a contest that goes on, the Ingersoll Rand Pit Crew Contest that goes on every race in the Grand National Race. And there's a lot of factors that go into a fast pit stop. A car may only be halted, say, 18 or 20 seconds, but what really counts is the amount of time the car spends off of the racetrack and the time it leaves turn number four and goes into turn number one.
So pit stops have been made under green. We are 51 laps into the Champion Spark Plug 400. We'll resume our live coverage on ESPN in just a moment.
We're talking stock cars. Number 98, that Levi Garrett car. Say that flavor. Say it proud. Say it loud. Taste that flavor coming through. Time after time, the quality comes through. Time after time, the quality comes through. That's why Levi Garrett is the brand I'm proud to use. Levi Garrett.
These days, when you're pumping your own gas, nobody's going to ask to check your oil. That's your job. And Pennzoil is the oil for the job.
When you're around golf course machinery as much as I am, you know you've got to check the oil to keep that engine protected. And you know you've got to use a quality oil. So when you check your oil, and you should, ask for Pennzoil.
Pennzoil. Quality protection. Ask for it.
From Pontiac comes
the one-of-a-kind 84 Firebird Trans Am. You can order it with aerodynamic ground effects, a high-output 5-liter V8, high-tech turbo wheels, and a close-ratio 5-speed. And knowing you, you probably will. Trans Am, only from Pontiac.
We build excitement, Pontiac.
Well, goodbye, good old Head and Shoulders. Gotta use new, improved Head and Shoulders. Come on, what makes this better than this?
Controls dandruff better than ever.
What's to improve? All right, it's richer. And it smells nice. Hey, really nice. Improved? It's great.
Hey, your hair looks gorgeous.
Yeah, well, always knew I'd like it better anyway.
New improved Head and Shoulders in regular and conditioning formulas.
With two-thirds of the Winston Cup Grand National Circuit completed in 1984, here are the point standings. Dale Earnhardt leading with 2,843 points, followed by Terry Labonte. Third is Bill Elliott. Fourth is Darrell Waltrip. And fifth is Harry Gant. In sixth place, Bobby Allison, the defending Winston Cup champion. Seventh is Neil Bonnet, who does not have a win this year. Jeff Bodine is eighth, Ricky Rudd is ninth, and Ron Bouchard is in tenth place. There is Bobby Allison, who has gone four laps further than anybody else, but finally makes the pit stop. He was shown as the leader until he came in, and now we are being told that Terry Labonte is back on the point.
And we watched Allison during that pit stop. They did not take the time to make any major chassis adjustments. I saw no one even go back into a rear window and jack weight around. The only thing I did notice was they were pounding on the rear spoiler. It looked like they were trying to push it up, maybe to put a little more drag on the rear end. Bobby perhaps complaining the car running a little loose, but no major adjustments or attempts at it during that pit stop.
And here is the leader, Terry Labonte, as he has gotten in and out of the pits faster than anybody else and is on the lead with Darrell Waltrip running in second spot. Running third unofficially is Bill Elliott. Fourth is Neil Bonnet. And fifth, Dale Earnhardt.
Bob, you know, you reflect back over the last three seasons of Grand National Stock Car Racing, and this guy and team may not have won a lot of races, Terry Labonte, but when it comes to consistency and running in the top five, nobody does it any better.
Gary Nelson is the crew chief on the Bobby Allison car, and he's with Dick Berger.
Gary, how is the car working at this point?
Well, it's not as good as we were hoping, but it is within adjustment, we think. We did a little bit on that pit stop. We'll see how it runs and get some comments from Bobby, and we'll keep working at it, and hopefully we can get up there with the leader.
Now, you set this car up so that you were hoping to be able to pull this win off this afternoon. What are your feelings about the probability of winning here at this point?
Well, you can never count Bobby Allison or Dygard out. As long as we're on the racetrack, we're going to do our best to win the race. So we're just going to keep working on the car, trying to get it to handle a little better. It was a little bit on the loose side. Really just a matter of trying to pick up a little more speed and get up there with the leaders.
So it's going to be a busy afternoon in Bobby Allison's pit.
Well, when we were at Pocono, there was quite a bit of controversy surrounding Bobby Allison and the possibility of him carrying extra fuel in that car to allow him to get the better mileage. We asked him about that.
Well, first of all, we know the charges aren't directed at our team. We get good mileage, but NASCAR has taken our car apart numerous times and drilled holes in it and gone through all sorts of gyrations and threats and all that. And we've come up clean, which we intend to keep on doing. However, some of the teams that have complained, if you really check the records, have gone further than we have. And when they go to the gas pump, nobody's checked them.
And so the controversy continues. Charges being flung at Bobby Allison, and Bobby flings them right back.
Bob, you know, it's an interesting story, this fuel controversy. It's funny how the prevailing attitude of thought has changed in the last month. About 3 or 4 weeks ago on the Grand National Trail, walk up and down pit road, and people were looking for hidden fuel. Now this weekend and walking around, the teams seem to have a different attitude as we go back and look at the race for second position between Waltrip and Bill Elliott. People are discovering that once they have concentrated on trying to stretch their fuel mileage, they are even finding more miles per gallon in their own race cars. And two or three of the top teams and top drivers said, you know, we really think that perhaps we haven't done as much or hadn't done as much homework as we should have until about the midpoint of the season, when two or three of the other teams are kind of blazing the trail for us. The prevailing attitude has changed. Most of the teams now think they got to work harder, that the other teams have simply found something more than they had. The other teams most commonly mentioned as having superiority in the fuel consumption race, Cale Yarborough and the number 28 car hooked up by Waddell Wilson, number 33 car of Travis Carter and Harry Gannon, of course, Bobby Allen.
So with nearly 60 laps completed, we'll run down as many as we can. We know there are those of you who like to keep score as you watch these races. The leader is Terry Labonte, second is Darrell Waltrip, third is Bill Elliott, fourth is Neil Bonnet, and fifth is Lake Speed. Running in sixth spot is Dale Earnhardt, seventh position is Cale Yarborough, eighth is Dave Marcus, ninth Richard Petty, and tenth is Harry Gant. Running in 11th spot is Benny Parsons, 12th position is Buddy Baker, 13th is Ron Bouchard, 14th is Jody Ridley, 15th Jeff Bodine, 16th is Bobby Allison, 17th is Rusty Wallace, 18th spot is Ricky Rudd, and in 19th is Tim Richmond. Junior Johnson continues to watch his drivers on the track, Darrell Waltrip and Neil Bonnet. Darrell Waltrip in second spot as this race with third place Bill Elliott is continuing. 61 laps now completed. ESPN and NASCAR present a track back. Copper wire that runs from the carburetor to the engine block may look like just any copper wire, but really it seals the carburetor to the engine. Now, during pre-race inspection, the NASCAR officials will check the carburetor to make sure that it meets all specifications. When it does, it's sealed on. Now, you can take off the ends of the carburetor here and adjust and change the jets to allow more fuel into the carburetor, but once the carburetor is on itself, it's sealed on.
Average speed of the race is 154.61. We continue under green at Michigan. More live coverage in just a moment.
Most guys spend Sunday taking it easy.
Not me.
When I'm racing the Bandit, there's no taking it easy. So I'm out here early before a race trying to relax.
Just me and my scope.
Just the paints gives me real tobacco pleasure without lighting up. And that wintergreen flavor's a real winner.
Go smokeless with Skoal or Copenhagen. A pinch is all it takes.
One shock of silver is so superior it has been used by every world champion for the past 13 years. Kone. Kone. So superior, they're standard on every Ferrari, on every Aston Martin, on Mustang SVO. Kone, the ultimate performance shock. Adjustable for wear, guaranteed for life. Less body lean, more stability, crisper handling. Put the world's finest performance shocks on your car. Kone, proven superior.
Review of the all-time winners in Winston Cup competition. Richard Petty with his 200th earlier this year at Daytona. Second on the all-time win list is David Pearson, who is already out of this race. Bobby Allison and Cale Yarborough each have 81 victories, and Darrell Waltrip is fifth with 60 wins. And as far as who's going to win this one, well, it's still very much up in the air as only 64 laps have been completed, but at this point, Terry Labonte is the leader, with Waltrip and Bill Elliott running second and third, and then Dale Earnhardt and Cale Yarborough. We're on the high banks of Michigan International Speedway. They're on the backstretch right now where the banking is just very slight. However, as they go to turns 1 and 2 and 3 and 4, they move up to 18 degrees of banking. There is the battle for second and third position. Well, earlier this year, there was an IndyCar race here and a lot of accidents. The most, at least terrible-looking accident involved Chip Ganassi. However, he was injured very slightly. As a matter of fact, was out of the hospital within a week. We are delighted to see Chip here this afternoon watching the Grand National cars. Here's Dick Berger.
Chip, how are you feeling?
Good. I'm still in one piece, Dick. My doctor said hopefully I'll be back on the track sometime around Labor Day, hopefully.
So what exactly happened to your car in that accident?
Well, we're really not sure yet. I think something broke in the left rear. either that or I just lost it over going on the exit of turn two.
What are your feelings about returning to racing? Are you anxious to get going again?
I'm very anxious. Very anxious. I'm just sitting it out here. I have a little bit of swelling on my head yet, and the doctor said anytime after Pocono, I'll be able to take a test to come back and drive. So should be labored.